Well, good evening, everybody, and welcome to tonight's City Council meeting. What a great crowd. We certainly appreciate you being here tonight. This is Tuesday, April 7th, and we'll start by introducing you to your City Council.
Council members Erickson.
Here.
Erpenbach.
Here.
Jameson.
Here.
Karski.
Present.
Kylie.
Here.
Rolfing. Steigers.
Present.
Anderson.
Here.
Very good. Thanks, Council. Appreciate that. We will start our meeting with an invocation. We're very blessed to have Pastor Fred Wilgenberg of the Center of Hope Ministry here in Sioux Falls will lead us with that invocation. What we'd ask you to do is to stand. Pastor Fred will give us that invocation and then remain standing for our Pledge of Allegiance. Pastor, welcome.
Thank you. Let us pray together. Father, thank you for giving people various talents and interests and for each of these people here this evening who care much about this, your City of Sioux Falls. Please guide the discussion this evening that decisions made will honor you and ultimately bless many people. Father, please provide safety to all police officers and fire and rescue workers. Please guide the educators of all our children so they can grow up and be all whom you made them to be. Finally, Father, please provide mutual concern and care among all of the citizens of Sioux Falls and reconciliation in neighborhoods where that is especially needed. We trust you will answer all these prayers according to your perfect will and time. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, good evening, everybody, and again, welcome to tonight's City Council meeting. Certainly glad that you're here. I do have three proclamations that I would love to read on behalf of the 170,000 people who call this city home. I would like to start with National Service Recognition Day. Is Tony here? Tony Burke? Yeah, Tony, good to see you, buddy. How are you doing? Thank you. Thanks, Tony. Well, the first proclamation reads as follows, and if there's more to join you, Tony, would you mind introducing him before we start, please?
This is our Commissioner Chair, Michael Weiland, for Serve South Dakota, our staff, Amy House-Landowski, our State Director, Jill Dietz, two of our AmeriCorps members, Bethany Watros and Heather Alamang, and then to your left, we also have Connie Thomas, who's one of our staff, also Pat Humphrey and Christian Fox from Senior Corps.
Wow, Tony, nice job. Thanks for being here, everybody. Appreciate it. The proclamation reads as follows. Whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges. The nation's mayors are increasingly turning to national service and volunteerism as a cost-effective strategy to meet city needs. Whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants address the most pressing challenges facing our city, from educating students and providing health services to financial literacy for the underserved and disaster preparedness. Whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants serve in more than 60,000 locations across the country, bolstering the civic, neighborhood, and faith-based organizations that are so vital to our economic and social well-being. Whereas National Service represents a unique public-private partnership that invests in community solutions and leverages non-federal resources to strengthen community impact and increase the return on taxpayer dollars. Whereas National Service participants demonstrate commitment, dedication, and patriotism by making an intensive commitment to service, a commitment that remains with them in their future endeavors. Now, therefore, I, Mike Huther, Mayor of the City of Sioux Falls, do hereby proclaim April 7th, 2015 as National Service Recognition Day in Sioux Falls and encourage residents to recognize the positive impact of national service in our city and to thank those who serve and to find ways to give back to their community. Tony and team, again, thank you for all that you do to serve us. And if I could, just a round of applause, please.
Good job.
Good job. Thank you. Thank you. Good to see you all. Thank you. Thank you. Paul, where's Paul at? Paul Flocks. Paul, welcome. Come forward. Paul, is there anybody you want to introduce or just you, buddy? All right. Good to have you here, Paul.
Thank you.
Paul, thanks for being here tonight. Appreciate it. The proclamation reads, whereas adequate housing is a basic need and a right of all people, whereas April 11, 2015 marks the 46th anniversary of the enactment of the Federal Fair Housing Act of 1968, Title III of the Civil Rights Act, which states that discrimination in the sale and rental of housing is illegal when based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. Whereas the Fair Housing Amendments Act of 1988 extend fair housing rights on the basis of familial status to families with children and on the basis of handicap to disabled persons. Whereas the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota supports fair housing efforts to eliminate discrimination in housing and to educate home seekers, apartment managers, and apartment owners on federal and state housing laws. Whereas the City of Sioux Falls is committed to highlight the Fair Housing Law, Title VIII of the Civil Rights Act of 1968, by continuing to address discrimination in our community, to support programs that will educate the public about the right to equal housing opportunities, and to plan partnership efforts with other organizations to help ensure every American has the right to fair housing. Whereas, in order to heighten public awareness, the City of Sioux Falls wishes to focus public attention on April as Fair Housing Month. Now, therefore, I, Mike Huther, Mayor of the City of Sioux Falls, do hereby proclaim the month of April 2015 as Fair Housing Month in Sioux Falls and encourage all citizens and community organizations to celebrate the value of harmonious and diverse communities of neighbors and support the goal of equal housing opportunity for all people. Paul, thanks for all you do, and congratulations.
Thank you very much.
Mary, thank you. Mary, welcome. And would you mind letting people know what you do for the City of Sioux Falls, and then introduce your fine guests, too. Thank you.
I'm Mary Michaels with the Sioux Falls Health Department and an initiative called Live Well Sioux Falls, which is community partners working together to make our community a healthier place to live. And with me tonight is Megan Myers with the American Heart Association and Marianne Zinnel, one of the managers of a Walgreens store in town, who work with the project that we're talking about tonight.
Mary, thank you, and welcome. The proclamation reads, whereas one in every three American adults has high blood pressure, that's one in three, also called hypertension, and millions more have high blood pressure and don't even know it. Whereas high blood pressure is often called the silent killer because it often comes with no symptoms. Whereas by not addressing high blood pressure, individuals are at a greater risk for stroke, heart attack, heart failure, or kidney failure. Whereas the benefits of lowering blood pressure are great. Reduced incidence of heart disease and stroke, as well as healthcare savings. In fact, by lowering blood pressure, we could save an estimated $46 billion in our country, which is the cost of medical services, medications, and work absences attributed to hypertension. Whereas all citizens need to know their blood pressure numbers, the risk factors contributing to high blood pressure, and how to take action to control high blood pressure. Whereas 2015 marks the fifth annual Big Squeeze Blood Pressure Screening Event. Now, therefore, I, Mike Huther, Mayor of the City of Sioux Falls, do hereby proclaim April 2015 as the Big Squeeze Month in Sioux Falls and urge all citizens of our city to familiarize themselves with the risk factors associated with high blood pressure, to know their numbers, and to take action if they have high blood pressure to reduce the devastating effects of heart disease, stroke, or other diseases related to high blood pressure. Mary knows I have been squeezed as part of the Big Squeeze, and I too would encourage all of you to be squeezed as well. Mary, on behalf of the city, thank you for what you're doing. Thank you, Megan. Good to have you here, and thank you as well to represent Walgreens as our partner on this effort. Appreciate it. Audience, thank you. Council will now move to our consent agenda. Any motions or changes to that?
Move to approve, Karski.
Second, Anderson.
Councilor Karski has made a motion to approve our consent agenda, seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. Yes, Councilor Karski.
Yes, Mayor, I have make a motion to amend the consent agenda by removing the following line item from item number one. That item being Parks and Recreation, project number 14022, development of play structures to award a bid by vendor Dakota Fence for the amount of $358,000. I understand the Parks Department is not ready to move forward with this one.
Thank you.
Second, Erpenbach.
Councilor Karski, thank you. Councilor Erpenbach, thank you as well. Any other motions? Councilor.
Yes, I'd like to pull one item from the consent calendar from Parks and Recreation. Dog park development, $58,492 for planning for a park, dog park.
Councilor, thank you. We'll certainly bring that up later. Councilor?
I just wanted to make sure we voted on the amendment that Councilor Staggers didn't have to have his, it doesn't need a second. So okay. We needed to vote. I just want to be sure we're doing that right.
Very good. If there's no other discussion, a roll call vote on the amendment.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Yeah, 7-0. Thank you. We now have a main motion. A roll call vote, please.
Main motion as amended. Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Thank you. Council will move to our regular agenda. Any changes to that tonight?
Move to approve, Anderson.
Second, Karski.
Councilor Anderson has made a motion to move forward with our agenda tonight, seconded by Councilor Karski. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Thank you. Welcome to tonight's meeting. You also have the opportunity to engage the council in topics that are not on the agenda later on tonight. If any of you want to come forward to talk for a bit, please do so. Just introduce yourself to the people of our town, and if you could keep your comments to 5 minutes or less, the council would appreciate that. Any comments? Paul, welcome.
Good evening. My name is Paul Flogstead. And I just wanted to explain a little bit about our Fair Housing Proclamation that the mayor was so gracious to sign for us. I've been hired as a consultant to the Community Development Awareness Program. We're working on fair housing awareness. And the program is many faceted. One, we developed a website for the citizens to go to find out any questions that they may have. Second, our phase is presentations. I, as an ombudsman, are going out to various groups, neighborhood associations, staff and clients, social service agencies, to whoever really wants it at any time. We're doing it on weekends, at nights. Instead of having a presentation at the library from 8 to 5, nobody shows up. So we go out and meet the people where they're at. We had, in 2014, we had 3,108 attendees. We also have posted a lot of information throughout the city, at the library and other agencies. Thirdly, we have an ombudsman program, and I am the ombudsman, and I try to provide correct information to help mediate complaints wherever possible. Many times it's an impartial third party who steps in and facilitates this mediation to the satisfaction of all the parties. And through the period of time from April through December of 2014, I took 694 calls. Many of the calls just had questions or needed some information. Of those calls, there were 298 actual complaints. The complaints range from landlord-tenant issues to true fair housing violations. Of the complaint calls, 71%, or 212 calls, would be classified strictly as landlord-tenant. The balance of 86 would be fair housing. In 2014, I mediated 69 of these cases without a formal complaint needed to be filed with HUD. However, 17 cases did have to refer to HUD for further action. Most of these cases had to do with companion animals and the landlords not understanding the rules regarding them or the tenants not understanding that. And most of the landlords and tenants were compliant and were appreciated for an explanation of these regulations. Other cases had to do with reasonable accommodations, occupancy, advertising, and racial discrimination. Some of the landlord-tenant cases had to do with improper evictions, unsafe property conditions, maintenance issues, bed bugs, and whatever after that. Much of this success of this program has been word of mouth, and typically a person who attends a presentation tells their friends and everyone else from that. I handed out over 2,100 business cards with a fair housing awareness on it. Success of this program has been due to the forward thinking of the Community Development Department and you as a city. Other departments have been working with us. We've worked with planning and zoning, with building services, and we also try to do a lot of meetings. At the request of the mayor, the city holds a semi-annual meeting with all of the landlords in the city, and we try to visit with them and explore how everybody can work together to solve the problems. And the first year has been really a success, exceeded expectations, and I think by the recent activity, this year is going to be much better than that. So I just wanted to explain that. Thank you very much.
Paul, thank you for your efforts. We appreciate it. Mm-hmm. Ma'am, welcome. Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Good evening. My name is Joy Tuescher. On St. Patrick's Day, I attended the Bob Seger concert, which was my first opportunity to experience the Denny Sanford Premier Center. When I reached the elevator, I was disheartened to see a group of persons with disabilities competing for use of the elevators with food carts and numerous event staff that were congregating, congesting the entire elevator area. I told my girlfriend and the disabled people around me that whatever we've got going on trumps whatever they're doing. We are the customers. So we moved forward. One staff member told me that he would squeeze against the wall as best he could, which allowed a small group of us to enter the elevator. And then another staff member shoved in a large feeder cart, crowding the elevator, taking up space that should have belonged to human beings. There was a culture of disrespect for those of us with disabilities. The concert is about to start, and there was a line of disabled people waiting. It was just so idiotic. What I have since learned is that in your years of studying the design for this facility, you went through the mental process of purposely choosing not to build a specific freight elevator. Thus, you turned every elevator in the Premier Center into a shared freight elevator. You chose the ambiguity of the ADA's laws concerning the use of shared freight elevators over the needs of people with disabilities. Now, let's get to the big secret about what happened that night as I was exiting. I walked to the elevator and found a large group of people waiting. Because we had been waiting for so long ourselves, I walked to the front to press the elevator button and then asked a woman in a motorized wheelchair, "What's going on with the elevator?" She replied, "I don't know, but I have been sitting here for so long that I'm calling the Premier Center, but I can't get through." And no staff anywhere, just an ever-growing crowd of people pressing us forward. With nowhere to go, a group of us who were ambulatory headed down the emergency stairwell. When I reached the bottom and found a staff person, I asked, "What's going on with the elevator?" He told me, "Ah, it's stuck." And I said, "Well, when were you planning on telling the people who are sitting and standing and waiting for it?" He replied, "They'll probably send someone." And I said, "No, you be that someone." He shrugged his shoulders and walked away. The next day, I made calls to Ovation's food service manager, Chad Stoner, and to Bill Murray, the operations manager of the Premier Center. 2 days later, I received a call back from Chad in which he informed me that staff had been very well trained on who gets to go first on the elevator. I replied, "Well, obviously, you're not done training," and he agreed. He promised to follow up with me and never called back, nor did he return any of my calls. Later that same day, I received a call from General Manager Terry Torkelson, who thanked me for giving him the perspective of somebody on a different level of the building waiting for an elevator that wasn't coming. Before calling me, he reviewed security tape and discovered a designated staff person assigned to the elevator went for help and never came back. Over 10 people were stuck in that elevator for some 20 minutes. I don't know exactly how Mr. Torkelson has managed to placate these people. What we are paying them in recompense, or are they planning their own formal complaint? And where is the Americans with Disabilities Policies and Procedures Manual that the Premier Center's website's ADA page touts has been available upon request? I have asked for it several times. The last time I was told, it's here somewhere, we just don't know where. But when we find it, we'll sure send it out to you. I have been waiting for the appearance of this manual since March 20th. If it existed, I would have it by now. After Mr. Torkelson was questioned about this by the Argus leader yesterday, he removed the entire paragraph from their ADA page. The ADA page never has and does not now say anything about the use of elevators. And why would it? How are you going to explain on your ADA page that every disabled person who needs to use the elevator is considered shared freight, and in an emergency, you may be left behind? If this had been a true emergency, although for the people stuck inside the elevator for some 20 minutes, it was an emergency, an active shooter, a tornado, a fire, if the Premier Center was a sinking ship, staff would have been the first out on a lifeboat, and the rest of us would have gone down with the ship. Now I know that you all value me as cargo when it comes to paratransit, but I will not be considered freight in a multi-million dollar event center that I supported with my vote and my tax dollars. When I reached out to Sioux Falls Human Relations Commission to offer a complaint, Carol Gary told me I would have to call the South Dakota Division of Human Rights. When I did, Director Marsh informed me that they were unable to accept my complaint and I would have to file my grievance with the Department of Justice's Civil Rights Division, which I have done. Regardless of the actions of the Department of Justice, the fact that I am able to stand here tonight and expose your lack of consideration for the needs of those with disabilities empowers me. God bless every veteran who ever served for my right to stand here and complain. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Joy. We appreciate that. Is there anybody else who wanted to speak? Welcome.
Good evening. I'm Arthur Krenz from Dance Gallery at 218 South Main Avenue and here to address the parking shortage in downtown, specifically along Main Avenue. We've been in business for 16 years and bring approximately 80 to 100,000 people a year downtown. And because of the lack of parking spots available, we have parents dropping kids off in the street sometimes and creating an unsafe situation. Parents say it, they are doing it because they don't have any place to park as downtown develops and grows. We're currently working with the police department, Sergeant Toom, to educate the parents and make them aware of the dangers of this practice. We've asked for the speed trailer to be set up to help monitor the traffic that's coming down the street to help slow people down. But one of the things I'm here to ask for is the road diet project, which there was a meeting recently, but we didn't get informed because we were not a property owner. That they have decided to keep the parking spaces at the 45 degree angle. And according to the engineering department, when that was changed from 60 to 45 degrees, there was approximately 20 spaces lost along the Main Avenue area. And those 20 spaces are gonna be critical as the pizza and pub comes in, the space next door to it that's just a workshop at this point, eventually someday that's gonna fill in. As just the whole downtown continues to grow, we need every single space. I know some people have said, well, when the parking angle was changed, it was to make it easier to back out. I invite you to come on over at 5 o'clock and try parking at a 60-degree angle and backing out and a 45-degree angle and backing out. And as long as the traffic is still going by at a very fast speed, it doesn't make any difference. Or if you're parked next to an SUV, it doesn't make any difference. Another parking issue was on the north side of Home Federal. There used to be six spaces that had meters that got changed to leased parking spaces by the parking department. Had a nice conversation with Matt Nelson from the parking department, and he said they did that because of revenue, that they're with a lease spot, they can have the spots generating money all day long, where with meters they can't. And the impact on us is that we grew with those spaces over the last 15, 16 years as being metered spaces, and that takes six cars off of those diagonal spots, and we used to take them off the street and have them in that lot and keep spaces open as our parents are continually turning over throughout the day or throughout the evening. So that is my request, is to please consider that when the engineering brings it up for review, to take a look at making those parking spaces as many as possible. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anyone else who, welcome.
Evening, Mr. Mayor, council members, Rick Albright from Sioux Falls. I wanted to highlight an issue that impacted me and the citizens of Sioux Falls and the surrounding area at the regional airport. You may have read an article on Monday's paper, about a page and a half, that dealt with my concerns or my issues when I tried to travel to India. This was with a ticket agent there with American Eagle Airlines. She was unfamiliar with the type of visa that I had to get to India. It was a valid visa. I had paperwork explaining the program through which I had gone. To get the visa, I had the application and the approval, which is recognized by the Department of State and other airline officials. She would not recognize that visa. She would not speak to a travel agent that I had on the phone. She would not speak to flight personnel that I had on the phone. She disregarded the instructions from American Airlines International Flight Reservations personnel to let me on the plane. She said she alone was in charge of determining who would get a boarding pass. I spoke with TSA, I spoke with Homeland Security. None of them were able to come to my assistance because she is the only one that issues boarding passes and she controls access to the TSA site. Over the course of 2.5 hours, I spoke with her four times. She would not get a supervisor. She would not consult with the other regional charter airlines that are there. She would not consult with a national authority to determine whether or not I had the valid paperwork, nor would she give me a number that I could call to assist her in that endeavor. As a result, I went through and I had to pay another $550 to get me just to London. And then to go from London to India, it would have cost another $2,000. Fortunately, the flights were delayed, and I had to overnight in Chicago, and the people in Chicago were able to assist me. American Airlines personnel there said, "Sir, everything you have is in order. We will redo your tickets. You will not have to pay anything else, and when you get back to Sioux Falls, file a claim." I don't know if there's such animosity between the regional carriers here at our local airport. I don't know why they won't consult with each other. I don't know why they're fearful to consult with their supervisors or national authorities. I don't know who's responsible for updating the training that they receive, or if anybody is in charge of supervising their activity at the airport. But if it happened to me, it could happen to anybody. The American Eagle falls underneath an organization called Worldwide Flight Services, which is based out of Irving, Texas. Those people said that they were sorry. At this point, I don't know whether when they say they're sorry, if they're apologetic, or if they're just indicating that they are absolutely pathetic. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Folks, is there anybody else who wanted to speak? Welcome.
Good evening. Shereen Ranch. I'm the Executive Director of Sioux Falls Housing Redevelopment Commission. I wanted to talk about an item on your agenda that's a first reading, so this is an appropriate time to address that. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. It's item number 40. That's where there's a change, proposing change in ordinances. It's 30.026 or 25 about the creation of agencies, authorities, committees. And I reviewed that, and because the Sioux Falls Housing Redevelopment Commission is one of the appointed commissions, and the Housing Commission is established in accordance with state law. And I know a lot of the proposals do have the wording that say except as otherwise provided by this code or state law, which is fine because that covers any discrepancies, except paragraph F, which states that a citizen appointees who miss more than 50% of the board meetings in any calendar year may be removed by the mayor for cause. I would recommend that you add that except as otherwise provided by this code or state law, because the way it reads with South Dakota Codified Law 11-7-14, I don't believe that the mayor would have the authority to remove a commissioner for that reason. So I just wanted to point that out, that you might want to check into that.
Thank you, Shereen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Welcome.
Scott Erisman, Sioux Falls, South Dakota. First off, I'd just like to recommend that you probably contact the ACLU for your problems. ACLU. Okay. Thank you. Mm-hmm. A few things. I have about three things I want to talk about tonight. First, I want to talk about how I attended the Dudley House meeting last night. And as some people may know, I'm kind of a hard ass, and I don't change my mind.
Scott, yeah. Can I ask you, if you're going to speak to the people of the town, because they are watching, if you could watch your language, we'd certainly appreciate it. Okay. I would appreciate it. The council would appreciate it. And I can guarantee you the people of Sioux Falls would appreciate it. So you can continue as long as you watch your language.
Thank you. I don't change my mind very often. I went to the meeting last night, and I had a total change of heart after leaving. I feel very comfortable that the house is going to do the things that they need to do to make it a better neighborhood. It's going to take time. The summer is going to be rough. I can guarantee it. The cops know that. They were there. They were telling us this. It's going to be a rough summer, but in the long run, the house is going to do good, and it's going to do good for the neighborhood. I'd also like to thank all the public officials who showed up, including Michelle and Kenny, Pat Kirschman, who's a state legislator, Darren Smith was there, and several police officers and Officer Larson. Officer Larson did a fantastic job of not sugarcoating anything. He told us what was going to be expected and what was going to happen, and I really appreciated that. And I kind of felt bad for Michelle. I was leaving because she was getting near full from a business owner in the neighborhood that I frequent, the business, and she sat and listened, and that was good. But I spoke up last night at the meeting because I really felt that the process to begin with wasn't good to start with. The neighbors were not listened to. They warned you about what was going to happen there. It happened. And from now on, I think anytime we have some kind of social service thing come before us, we really need to listen to what they're telling us, because they've lived there for several years. There's one guy who's been there for, his business has been there for 30 years. He knows what he's talking about. I want to move on to this jobs website. And while it's all well and good, and whatever it is, Sioux Falls doesn't have a jobs issue. I can drive down any street of this town, and I can see help wanted signs everywhere. We know people are hiring. We know there's a jobs issue. There is not a jobs issue. There's a wage issue, and we know it. And Rick pointed it out, even though he didn't say it, he pointed it out. These people are not getting paid. They're not well trained. She pointed it out at the event center. It has to do with how we're paying people. And let's just face it, that's what it is. It has nothing to do with people getting jobs. It has to do with how we're paying them. I came here a couple months ago. I told you the living wage for an individual is $16 an hour. I want you to go to the website tomorrow, And I want you to find how many of those jobs on that website are paying at least $16 an hour. They're not. We need to face the facts in this community. It is about paying people, and it is about training them well, and about qualifying them. That's what it's about. It's not about billboards. It's not about these companies who can't hire people. It is about paying people a living wage. And it's statewide. It's not you guys. I mean, we could talk about city councils and all that, but it's not. It's statewide. It's a travesty. As I watched the city council meeting of Aberdeen last night, and we had a state legislator for 12 minutes talk about how it was fair to pay teenagers $7.50 an hour. It was disgusting that this man ever served in peer to be arguing that a teenager is only worth that. I made $8 an hour in 1988 working for a plumber at the age of 17. I'm sorry, we have a bigger issue here and I hope you guys explore it. I wanna finish, if I still have some time. I went and saw Chief Barthel speak at the Democratic Forum, and he said some things that kind of worried me a little bit. He talked about the release of police videos. Somebody asked him the question of why they don't release them. He said that state law says they don't have to, and that is true. They don't have to. State law does not have to release police videos, but they can. If Barthel chooses to release these police videos to the media, he can release them. And what amazes me is that, think about all the crimes that are solved when we release videos at banks and casinos and people identify things, and how awesome that is that somebody goes, oh, I know that person, and crimes get solved. So why is it that we wouldn't want to release police videos to solve crimes? I asked him about Todd Hill. I said, why aren't we releasing the audio of the officer? He said, I don't feel that it would solve the crime. Well, how do you know? Release the audio. Somebody might recognize something in that audio that would find this person. Sioux Falls is the largest city in this state. I think we should take a forefront in transparency and say, we're going to release audio and video of our police officers if we really believe the public is going to help us solve crimes. And put your foot forward and say, we're going to do it. Because it's not against the law to put these videos out there. It's only against the law if they release them and peer, oh, never mind. But anyway, that's all I have tonight. Thank you.
Thanks, Scott. Ms. Haley, go right ahead. We'll get it.
I just don't want that to be part of my 5 minutes.
We're ready for you.
Okay. Good evening. I'm Teresa Staley. And as some of you may know, I was the co-chair of the movement Citizens for Snowgates that was formed about 2.5 years ago. And it was a group of citizens who wanted to bring that issue of snowgate usage in our community to a vote. And I have to give credit to our mayor, Mike Huther, because if you had not tested these, people wouldn't have tasted them and known that they were working. I do think it was important to put it into an ordinance form so that it's part of our city law that they would be used. Before I get into the Snowgate issue, I want to talk about the energy I've seen in the past summers that the mayor at our code enforcement department has put into the brochures you've sent out, encouraging people to turn in neighbors who are creating a nuisance. And in those brochures, there's always just encouragement to watch out, be watching out, we want to have a good community, and you have phone numbers there. So it's always right there, easily accessible, user-friendly. And we also have had in the past the pothole hotline. I think, are we still doing that? Yes, okay. So, and again, there's a number you can call and let the city know if there's a problem. So I want to bring the same energy into the Snowgate situation. And we kind of got, I wanted the whole overhead on there, but it's called Snowgate's Winners and Losers this season. As the person who helped with this, I've gotten lots of phone calls and had conversations with people about Snowgates. Some people have been very happy with what has happened. Other people have been disappointed in the service that they've received. And as I've had conversations with Galen Huber and Mark Cotter, it's become obvious that there's some inexperience with the drivers, and we have a learning curve that we're working on. And what I am proposing is that we have an accountability in place, and a way of having accountability with these drivers. I would like to see a number put on each motor grader. I'd like that number to be big enough that we could see that from our windows as they're coming past at night. And it would be easy to do with just a black stick-on marking that you would have. And that way I could say, oh, gee, I could call in and say, number 58 did a great job in my driveway. Or number 75 only did half of the driveway. I've talked with people, and there seems to be some areas get very good service, other areas maybe not as proficient. And I'll relate it to the when you're driving behind a semi on the interstate. Have you ever seen that where it says, how's my driving? There's a phone number. I think we all do a little bit better when we think we're being watched. There's a little oversight. So why not have that happening on with our motor graders? And then the other thing I'd like to do is have a Snowgate hotline. There's been two mailings that I've gotten in with my water bill, but there's no phone number and there's no encouragement for us to call in if there's a problem. And I've seen Galen Huber interviewed on Kello, and he didn't mention, I mean, and I was very happy with the positive approach he took, but he's not encouraging people to call in. And there needs, just like with when you have that nuisance neighbor brochure, you have phone numbers. I'd like to see phone numbers with the Snowgate brochures that we do. Yesterday, my co-chair from the Snowgate petition drive, Harold Gilsrud, and I met with the street supervisor, Galen Huber, to discuss these issues. Galen assured me that he wants to do everything in his power to give us first-rate top service for all citizens. I also called the company, the Hankey Company, yesterday after my conversation with Galen, because he said one of the big problems is that as they're coming around a corner, the first homes on the pass, they do a great job, and then as they're coming, it gets kind of clogged up, and we don't get as satisfactory job done. And I told the company that, and they said they need to be trained, the drivers, to pull back a little bit, empty the snow out, and it should be the same service for everyone on the block. So I know they've been here a few times to train, and Galen said, well, we want to do this quickly. We want to have a fast response. And I said, I think people voted on this. They said, we understand it might take a little more time, but we want it to be done well. So that's I'm requesting that we would do this. I will continue to request that we have some kind of ID on a big ID marker on the motor graders, and then we have that phone number available, and so that as we progress on, it becomes we're all winners in this for all of our citizens. Thank you.
Is there anyone else who wants to engage the council on a topic that's not later on in the agenda? Well, thank you very much. Council, let's move now to Councilor Staggers had an item he wanted to discuss involving a dog park development. It's a $58,492 item. Councilor Staggers, what were your comments on that, please?
Yes, I've talked to Don Kearney, the head of the Parks Department, about this, and Don realizes that I think we could probably spend money better than on a dog park. In fact, this is just to plan for a dog park, the $58,492. So I would hope that we would vote this down and then later use the $58,000 for something more worthwhile for the city.
Councillor, thank you.
Move to approve, Karski.
Second, Erpenbach.
I've got a motion to approve this item. It has been seconded. Roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Stagers?
No.
Anderson?
That has passed 6-1. We'll now move on to item 25.
Item 25 is a new 2014-15 retail malt beverage license for JLB SF2 Incorporated, JL Beers, to be operated at 3623 Southwestern Avenue, CUP not required, pending final inspections per fire, health, and building services. Item 26 is a new 2015 retail wine license for JLB SF2 Incorporated JL Beers to be operated at 3623 Southwestern Avenue, CUP not required, pending final inspections per fire, health, and building services. Item 27 is a special one-day malt beverage and special one-day wine licenses for Catering America Incorporated, Chef Dominique's, to be operated at Avera Prairie Center, 1000 East 23rd Street, for a retirement social on April 9, 2015. Item 28 is a special one-day malt beverage and special one-day wine licenses for Catering America Incorporated Chef Dominique's, to be operated at Avera E-Care, 4500 North Lewis Avenue, for a social event on April 9, 2015. Item 29 is a special one-day liquor license for Ovations Food Services LP, Sioux Falls Convention Center, to be operated at Sanford Research Center, 2301 East 60th Street North, for a dinner on April 15, 2015. Item 30 is a special one-day liquor license request for Hy-Vee Incorporated, All Occasions by Hy-Vee, to be operated at The Point is to Serve Church, 506 North Kiwanis Avenue, for weddings on April 18th and 25, 2015. Item 31 is a special one-day malt beverage and special one-day wine licenses for the Sioux Falls Jazz and Blues Society to be operated at Yankton Trail Park, 3901 South Minnesota Avenue, for the Jazz Fest on July 16th to 18th, 2015. Item 32 is a special one-day malt beverage and special one-day wine licenses for the Sioux Falls Jazz and Blues Society to be operated at Vern ID Acura, 4030 South Grange Avenue, for a fundraiser on September 12th, 2015.
Jamie?
Good evening, Jamie Palmer with licensing. Items 25 and 26 are for the second location of JL Beers in Sioux Falls. It'll be on the east end of Borrowed Bucks Roadhouse. Their tentative opening date is May, and items 27 through 32 are special one-day events throughout Sioux Falls. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Jamie, thank you. Council?
Move to approve.
Second, Erpenbach.
Councillor Jameson, thank you. Councillor Bach, thank you. He's been a motion, has been seconded. Roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Stagers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 33.
Item 33 is a second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at the southwest corner of West 26th Street and South Katy Avenue, from the RS Single Family Residential Suburban District to the RA1 Apartment Residential Low Density District, petition number 2223-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
Diane? Good evening, Diane DeCoyer with Planning. This is a rezone, as Tamara said, for the RS Single Family Residential to the RA1 Apartment Residential Low Density District for allowed forms. The applicant is Clint Ackerman. It's located at the southwest corner of West 26th Street and South Katy Avenue. The parcel is 4.96 acres. The purpose is to construct low-density apartments. The proposed zoning meets the SHAPE Sioux Falls comprehensive plan. The applicant is proposing to construct 8 apartment buildings, with 6 buildings containing 7 apartments and 2 buildings containing 14 apartments, each with their own 2-stall car garage. Each building is 2 stories tall and meets the criteria of no more than 24 units per structure in the RA1 Apartment Residential Low Density Zoning District. And I can answer any questions you might have.
Diane, thank you. Folks, this is the second meeting. Did anybody want to speak on behalf of this item or against the item? Very good. Council, questions, comments for Diane?
Move to approve, Erickson.
Second.
Councilor Erickson made a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Karski. If there is no discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson.
Yes.
Erpenbach.
Yes.
Jameson.
Yes.
Karski. Kylie.
Yes.
Staggers.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 34.
Item 34 is an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at 1116 South 4th Avenue from the RT1 Single Family Residential Traditional District to the S1 General Institutional District, petition number 2243-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. Planning Commission recommends approval.
Diane?
Good evening. The applicant for this is Dakota Abilities. I believe both Bob Bohm and Nathan is available for questions. This is located at the southeast corner of East 19th and South 4th Avenue, which is the current site for Longfellow Elementary School. School is vacating the property in June, and Dakota Abilities will take it over at that time. Parcel is 3.67 acres, and the purpose is to change use from an elementary school to the Dakota Abilities Office and Work Center. They have provided the appropriate documentation, an update on what their parking plan is, and we feel that that meets the requirement. So our recommendation is approval. I can answer any questions you might have.
Diane, thank you. Is there anyone in the audience wanting to speak to this item? Council?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Karski.
Councilor Anderson Jr. has made a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Karski. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson.
Yes.
Erpenbach.
Yes.
Jameson.
Yes.
Karski.
Yes.
Kylie.
Yes.
Staggers.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Thank you. Item 35.
Item 35 is the second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at 633 West 10th Street from the RT2 Townhome Residential Traditional District to the RA1 Apartment Residential Low Density District, petition number 2286-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls.
Diane?
Good evening again. The applicant for this is Wayne Wagner from Affordable Housing Solutions. It is located at the southeast corner of West 10th and Summit Avenue. This is currently a vacant site. The property is approximately 0.28 acres. The proposed zoning meets the SHAPE Sioux Falls comprehensive plan. The parcel is located within a redevelopment area. The existing zoning allows for up to 8 unit attached townhomes. The applicant is proposing to construct the same number of 8 units. However, they would be apartment style instead of already permitted attached dwelling townhomes. Finally, the required level A buffer yard on the south side should provide the necessary buffering from the proposed 8-unit multifamily residential to the existing single family residential to the south. And I can answer any questions you might have.
Diane, thank you. Any comments on this from anybody in the audience? Councilors?
Move to approve, Karski.
Second, Kylie.
Councilor Karski would like to make a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Kylie. If no discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson.
Yes.
Erpenbach.
Yes.
Jameson.
Yes.
Karski.
Yes.
Kylie.
Yes.
Staggers.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Item 36.
Item 36 is a second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at 3204 Southwest Avenue from the RD1 Twin Home Duplex Residential Suburban District to the RT1 Single Family Residential Traditional District, petition number 2287-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. Planning Commission recommends approval.
The owner and applicant for this is Tony Brown. He is with Dakota Sod Farm. The property is located at 3204 Southwest Avenue. This is just north of 41st Street. The size of the parcel is 0.13 acres, and the purpose is just to construct a house and garage on the property.
Diane, thank you. Anybody want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Jameson.
Thank you, councilors. Appreciate that. Councilor Jameson.
Diane, do you have the other drawings of the house's placement on the...
There you go.
You know, just recently we've been dealing with a... I guess we haven't, but the city has dealt with a large home built next to another home. Have you considered those in the setbacks and any issues there that have been between the other neighbors? Any issues?
I can guarantee you the size of this house is nothing compared to the one that we've been looking at. But the setbacks within the RT1, which is a traditional zoning for this, does allow for a little bit of a reduced side yard setback. As you can see, assuming north is up on this, that it is 3 feet to the north and I believe 8 feet there on the south. I don't know what the adjacent property is for their setback, but given that it's probably a traditional setback in that RD1, I'm assuming it's at least 5 feet there. But I can verify that if you would like.
Well, I think it's a great time to maybe take just a slower step in the process of doing that, that we just don't wind up down a path that is not good. And the idea that the neighbor is in agreement, not that they should control the other neighbor, but we're doing it in a standard that is acceptable, I guess that's what I'm really after. And if we're following the standards for that neighborhood, that's probably most important. But yeah, I mean, if you could check on that.
Okay, would you like to defer this item?
I don't think so, but unless there's an issue that I guess, you know, you can't really fix it later, but is there a timeline that the applicant is after as far as?
It would become effective 20 days after the approval tonight, so I can get you that answer tomorrow if you would like.
Diane, were there any concerns expressed by any of the neighbors?
No, we didn't get any phone calls or there wasn't anybody present at the Planning Commission to talk about it.
Councilor Buck.
Could you go back to the overhead or the aerial view of that lot? It has a house on it existing, at least in this shot. Has that been torn down?
I don't believe that they've already gotten their demo permit on it. So no, I don't believe so.
So it is, it's a very traditional neighborhood built in the 40s and 50s. It's
correct.
It's not a historic neighborhood in any way.
No, it is not. And it is just a single story home that they are building.
I guess I would respectfully disagree that we need to hold off on this. This is one of those that, again, we don't have control over exactly what people build, but all we're doing is setting zoning. We aren't telling the guy where he's going to build the house. So I think we can go ahead and move tonight and those sorts of, when the building permits are set, then you can deal with setbacks and whatnot. I would move approval.
We've already got a motion. Yes, we got a motion. It has been seconded, but thank you for the double doing that. Appreciate that. If there is no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson.
Yes.
Erpenbach.
Yes.
Jamison.
Yes.
Karski.
Yes.
Kylie.
Yes.
Staggers.
Yes.
Anderson.
Yes.
Thank you, Council. That is passed 7-0. Item 37.
Item 37 is a second reading and ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property north of East 41st Street and west of South 6th Mile Road from the AG Agricultural District to the RS Single Family Residential, Suburban RD2 Townhome Residential, Suburban RA2 Apartment Residential, Moderate Density, and C2 Commercial Neighborhood and Streetcar Districts, Petition Number 2292-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. Planning Commission recommends approval.
The applicant for this project is Checkpoint from Ronning Enterprises. This is located at the northwest section of East 41st Street and 6 Mile Road. It is 121 acres. The purpose is to develop the property for single and multifamily residential and commercial adjacent to 41st Street and 6 Mile Road. The subject property is located within a neighborhood employment center designation on the 2035 future land use map. The suggested core districts with this employment center are C1 and C2 commercial districts. The C2 commercial neighborhood and streetcar district allows RE2 and RE3 forms, which allows a maximum of 25,000 square foot retail building. The applicant has shown appropriate transitions from the proposed C2 commercial neighborhood and streetcar district to the south along East 41st to RD2 townhome residential to the RS single family residential to the north. The proposed commercial on the east adjacent to 6 Mile Road will be required to provide a level C, which is a 30-foot buffer yard to the north adjacent to single family residential. I can answer any questions you might have.
Diane, thank you. Anybody in the audience want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Erpenbach.
Thank you both. Appreciate that. If there's no further discussion, a roll call vote, please.
Councilmembers Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. Thank you. Diane, just as a point of clarification, if in any of these zoning topics, if there's any neighbor complaints, you'll let the council know. Is that correct?
I will definitely.
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you. Very good. Item number 38.
38 is the second reading, an ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at the southwest corner of East 41st Street and South Sycamore Avenue from the C2 Commercial Neighborhood and Streetcar District to the C3 Commercial Community District, including conditions as allowed in Section 160.650E, placing limitations on regulations within the RE4 form, petition number 2298-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. The Planning Commission recommends approval subject to the building of no more than 30,000 square feet of gross floor area.
Diane?
The applicant for this is Jeff Johnson with Fairway Stores. Is this located at the southwest? Thank you. Southwest corner of 41st and South Sycamore Avenue. The parcel is 3.13 acres. The purpose is to construct a retail building at a maximum of 30,000 square feet. A level C buffer yard is required along the west property line, adjacent to the existing AD1 forms, which are twin homes across South Bedford Avenue. This buffer yard requires a 30-foot setback. However, a local collector street, South Bedford Avenue, can count as 50% of the buffer yard. Therefore, the buffer yard is 15 feet. Further, a 4-foot berm and 40 units of landscaping per 100 lineal feet are required within the buffer yard. Finally, the concept plan indicates a 21-foot buffer yard, whereas only 15 feet is required, and the required number of landscape units. This will be a conditional rezoning to restrict the owner from building no more than 30,000 square feet of gross floor area. The subject property is in conformance with the comprehensive plan. The proposed C3 commercial community district allows the RE4 form, which allows retail buildings to be constructed up to 75,000 square feet. The parcel is located at the intersection of 1 Type 2 East 41st Street and 1 Type 3 South Sycamore Avenue arterial streets as designated on the future land use map. However, staff feels the proposed building should not be larger than 30,000 square feet of gross floor area. Limiting the size should provide a better fit with the existing neighborhood and provide a better land use transition to the existing AD1 twin homes and single family land use to the west. Finally, the required level C buffer yard should minimize any incompatibilities with the proposed retail use to the existing residential uses to the west. And we did get quite a bit of neighborhood input on that, and I do believe there are a few people here to speak to it.
Diane, thank you. Folks, this is a great opportunity for you to engage the council on this topic. If you're here in the audience, just come forward. Welcome.
Good evening, councilors, mayor. My name is James Jacobson. I'm actually a neighbor in this neighborhood, just unfortunately slightly outside of the zone where the notification was given. So if you look at the map here, 42nd Street in Bedford, I'm one house in on 42nd Street. I've lived here since the house was built, nearly 8 years ago now. And we've seen a lot of development in this area. One of the things that drew me to this area originally, besides the fact growing up just across 26th Street over in Hilltop near Frank Olson Park, was the fact that this was a residential area. There was a small area of commercial development I knew because the gas stop was already there, and they had talked about other development. The bank had been there as well, along with another bank and real estate agency across the street on Sycamore. But it was always my understanding that, again, these types of developments were going to be conforming to the neighborhood feel of this. Again, there's no other commercial development for another mile outside of this, either down on Southeastern Avenue at 49th Street or up on 26th Street and Sycamore Avenue. I think that the challenge that we have in this neighborhood is the fact that, you know, the rest of the buildings have been built to kind of blend into the neighborhood. They have green space in front of them. They have landscaping. The parking lots aren't too large. They're broken up if they are. And they really do a good job of kind of blending into the next transition of housing, which is the twin homes across the street on 42nd Street or on Bedford Avenue. I think the challenge that we're facing, everyone that I've spoke to is very much in favor of Fairway coming into the neighborhood. I love Fairway myself. I think it'd be a good fit for the neighborhood within allowing for a neighborhood grocery store. But again, I think part of it is the transition that we have then coming from a very residential area into this very commercial area. If you could bring back up the site plan again, please. Basically, and I had emailed all of you a list of suggestions as to how to perhaps allow for this development to be a little bit better suited for the neighborhood. If you can look at this right now, the parking lot there is nothing from Sycamore Avenue all the way up to the building, but concrete. There are no breaks for trees. There are no areas in front of it like the other commercial buildings around there that have some green spaces in front of it. It is literally all concrete all the way up to the brick facade of the building. I think that that is going to be a very big sore thumb for the neighborhood. Plus, we, as you folks have heard before, there's an awful lot of water issues and drainage issues with this. Having that big of area of open concrete that's just simply flowing, even with a detention area, is still going to create an awful lot of runoff. But had it, would it, if it would be broken up a little bit to have some green space in there, it would allow for a little bit more of a buffer for that water as well. So in talking with other neighbors and in talking with the gentleman that is planning on building the Fairway store, the suggestions that had been put out there would be that the design of the store incorporate green space and landscaping close to the building. The parking lot be at least 15% green space or landscaping with trees. Also to help with the look and feel of the site within our neighborhood, any signage that be placed from the building be of monument style and in no case larger than 7 feet tall, that a lit pedestrian walkway be established to maintain from Bedford Avenue to the north of Britza, which is just to the south or on the drawing right there, that there be an access point so that people who are coming from the neighborhood are able to actually walk to the store without having to go all the way around or try to cut across other parking lots or Britz's parking lot or their property as well. The other thing would be to ensure that the parking lot lights be of an appropriate height and style for the neighborhood with minimal light bleed into the neighborhood, and for its safety reasons, a minimal number of lights be remain lit overnight. And then also that any drainage or detention pond be landscaped and maintained, providing for an attractive screening and or safety fencing if standing water is anticipated to be held longer than 6 hours after a major weather event. So again, I would just simply appreciate that the council takes a look at this and allows for this development of this project, not only to, you know, allow for a good development within here, but also to help with the ease of transition from a very neighborhood environment to a commercial environment.
James, thank you very much. Appreciate it. Is there anybody else who wanted to speak on behalf of this item? Or against the item, sorry. Speak to the item. Welcome.
Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Jeff Johnson, Fairway Stores, Inc., 715 8th Street, Boone, Iowa. I guess I'd like to say that ahead of the Planning Commission meeting in March, we did bring the neighbors together in a neighborhood meeting, opened up our plan to them, listened to some of their concerns, and have tried to incorporate as many of those concerns or explain what's going on with our proposed project. And we've covered the litany with them, and I'm happy to discuss anything from stormwater drainage to lighting to building materials. landscaping. I will say that our preliminary plan, as we've reviewed the ordinances and regulations in C3 zoning, we're meeting or exceeding setbacks, materials, and landscaping. So we feel we're bringing a good plan together for the neighborhood and something I think the neighborhood supports. So with that, I'll open it to questions or any comments.
Jeff, thank you. Don't leave. There's a good chance that someone may ask.
Fair
thank
enough.
You.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who wanted to speak to this item? Welcome.
My name is Richard Moe. I live at 3401 South Bedford Avenue, directly across the street west of the proposed fairway site. I'm also the current president of the Bedford Homeowners Association. Many of our members were present at the meeting March 24th, in March, was referred to. The primary concern I've heard from the members of the association are to primarily keep Bedford Avenue as a residential street. Currently, there are no proposed access lanes for traffic from the fairway site, and the members of the association appreciate that greatly. And also, the other primary concern is to keep a neighborhood feel to the whole area. Some of our members have a great deal of concern about water drainage, and I think have been in direct contact with the members at Fairway about that issue. Other concerns that our members have expressed, at least to me, concern light spillage, building design, especially on the backside, the west side of the building, a sidewalk continuing north on the east side of Bedford Avenue, parking, signage, and traffic issues. My purpose here tonight is primarily to make the council aware of these concerns of the members of the Homeowners Association. Fairway Foods has done a very nice job, in my opinion, in accepting communication and participating in conversations about these issues from my members. Thank you.
Richard, thank you as well. We appreciate it. Anybody else want to speak to this item? Welcome.
Good evening. Chuck Point with Ronning Companies, 4401 East 6th Street. We're the owner of the property, and I just wanted to make a few comments and be available for any of your questions. But the Ronnings bought this property in 1985, either January or February of 1985. And for most of us, that would be a long time to hold a piece of property. But they've chosen to do that. They have had many opportunities to sell the property and have chosen not to, because for whatever reason, they didn't believe, as maybe some of the neighbors wouldn't have believed, that the offers that they received would have been for a use that would have been a good fit in the neighborhood. So they passed. Not all developers would have done that. That doesn't mean they're not good. It doesn't mean that we're not good. It's just a fact. So the property has been zoned as commercial since shortly after we bought it. We brought it to the Planning Commission. We brought it to the City Council. We have had sales information documents ever since we started selling the first lot in the neighborhood that designated this property. And I'll give one to Christine and I'll give another one to Michelle as C4. So there's no kind of argument in my mind, not that there isn't in somebody else's, that the property was ever something else, that somebody else thought it was something else. It's always been commercial, and it's always been intended to be commercial. Next, this is a neighborhood that is part of what I call transition. It is developed under the old plan of having grid streets. In other words, streets ran from one end to the other, both ways, however they could. We don't do that anymore. We have limited access onto arterial streets. Some arterials are very limited, others maybe not so much. This was developed not to be limited. Doesn't mean it's bad, it was just that's when it was developed. And so the access question that I don't hear tonight, but I have heard, we are matching, or they are matching, their access on 41st Street with their neighbor to the north, which is now a Holiday convenience store. So to me, that works good. I mean, that's kind of how this area was developed, the area to the north, the areas to the east were, again, developed under the older system. Thank you. Next, Fairway has been a true pleasure to deal with. And I can say that absolutely honestly, that they subscribe to the same kind of values that we do. They're good Midwest people. And when they came to us, they have never been presumptive of what could happen. They have been cooperative. And they have always surpassed what our expectations were, whether it was to the design of the site, the design of the building, the drainage on the site to off the site. They have exceeded our expectations on every one of those issues. And probably the one that has been most difficult in this area has been drainage. And there are a number of townhome or twin homes on 42nd Street that have suffered some drainage issues. There's no denying it. The question is, what was the cause of those problems? And we believe that today those issues have been resolved. Some were caused by the grading was done in the backyards of the twin homes. Others were caused by some occupants of some twin homes being more than excited about the amount of landscaping that they did in their backyard. Those issues, when they were brought to the attention, unfortunately, by somebody getting water in their basement in a 6-inch or 5-inch rain, but they were corrected. I was very happy after it happened that builders and landscapers did not argue, did not wait to get sued, did not go to court. They took the lead and went and fixed the problem. And when the builder said to me, Chuck, it appears that in a couple of the twin homes, the sump collection pits are overwhelmed. I said, that happens in some cases, and that's not a good thing, but here's the fix to it. You call your plumber, you install another pump that sits on top of a brick. It doesn't run very often, but when it does, it keeps up, it takes care of the problem. And again, to my knowledge, those two things have corrected the problems that had been regarding drainage. They are no longer. But even more important than that, our friends from Fairway did not bring us a plan that said, we will keep the site neutral in regard to drainage. We will not add to anybody's drainage problem. They brought us a plan that actually helps any drainage issues that are to the south of their site. And the engineer that designed it is here tonight. If you have questions, you can talk to him about it. I'm not an engineer. But basically what they've done is they've tipped the property to the north, the south end of the property to the north. They brought up a storm collection pipe from down by the Britza Dance Studio. It's not there yet, but they'll bring up, and it'll come in through that little rectangular dotted area and collect water in both the parking lot and in their loading dock. And it'll go out into a storm sewer. And again, a lot of water is going to go out onto 41st Street, and a lot of water is going to go out onto Sycamore. The people to the south will actually now have less water coming to their property than they do today. And again, it's my belief that today they don't have a drainage problem. It is not What I'm trying to tell you is that they never did, because they did.
Chuck, you're at 7 minutes. Normally, we allow 5 minutes. Counsel, in this case, I allowed Chuck to go on because I knew you were going to want to talk drainage anyway. I don't think he's saying he's a subject matter expert, but my gut says he's been pretty involved in this. So that's why I allowed him to continue talking on, it sounds like, on behalf of this. So, Chuck, do you have any other points that are...
I do, but I don't want to wear out my welcome.
The council will certainly engage probably you and others on this topic as well. So if you wouldn't mind, I'd appreciate that.
Thank
you for your comments. Is there anybody else who wants to speak to this item? Very good. Don't leave, because I'm sure the council has some questions. Councillor Jamieson.
Thank you. take a load off, Chuck. Sit down for a minute. So, Diane, a couple questions for you, if I could. I just want to be clear on the whole issue tonight. We're going from a C2 to C3. C2 would allow a 75,000 square foot.
C2 would allow 25,000 square feet, but they are over that. I think they're just under 28,000. We are restricting them. They could go up to 75,000 with a C3 RA4 form, but we are restricting them to a 30,000 square foot.
Could you bring up that map of the building that just...
Sure. Anybody want to give the guy downstairs a...
Okay. It was explained to me that the red line there really outlines the 25,000 square foot in the right, and the real outline of the real building there, the yellowish, is the 30 or the 28. Is that right?
I believe that is correct. So that's your difference between, the 28,927 and what a 25,000 square foot building would be.
Right, I think that's just a good reference. The change is minor.
Right.
One of the neighbors brought up I don't know that I want to go there. I think it's really about zoning here. And all things considered, I guess what I wanted to point out is the fact that if they went to the red line, we wouldn't be here tonight.
Right.
And I guess that's the point
exactly.
Of it all. That margin that we're talking about has caused us to
pretty minimal,
but still a further discussion about it. I would, if I could, make a motion to approve this item.
Second, Erpenbach.
It's been a motion to approve this item. It was seconded by Councilor Anderson Jr. Councilor. Other discussion, other questions? Yes, Councilor Erpenbach.
I do have questions about the drainage just a little bit.
Yes.
That is one that, as we all know, this council goes crazy about water once in a while. But I think Mr. Point brought up the idea that they're actually going to make this better. And so I'd like to understand that idea a little bit more clearly in terms of what is the water issue about.
And Andy Berg with engineering is here and probably
Andy,
answer.
Would you mind starting the dialogue?
So could you talk about what do we expect normally when we're building a parking lot like this? And then how is this one? Is it really different? Is it really going to make that big a difference?
Okay. Andy Berg, Public Works. When we look at these sites, we first look at, are there any drainage issues in the neighborhood? Right away, the first correspondence we had with their design engineer was the sensitivity of drainage to the south. We said there can't be any increase going to the south. 41st Street and Sycamore, there are not known drainage concerns in those areas, so then we just follow our engineering design standards, which basically hold it to not violating the standards for width of water flow in the streets and the discharge rates set by those standards. So when they I believe, and I'll have their engineer speak to this, but when they say making it better for those to the south, I believe they're changing that tipping point of where the water flows north versus south, and then they've got a potential detention area there that they'll be running that water to before it would go out onto Bedford Avenue into that storm sewer system. So I guess I would defer to their engineer to discuss the details on it. The plan review process is still to come on this, so we certainly look forward to reviewing it, and are well aware of the concerns in the area, so you know we will be reviewing this with a fine-tooth comb, I guess, to make sure that there is no negative impacts to that residential area to the south and to the west.
And I think that's my point. I think that over the years that some of us have been sitting up here, we've learned that, that really when we do this kind of development in Sioux Falls, we really do go crazy with it in terms of picking through every line item and making sure that it isn't going to adversely affect the neighbors. And I just want to hear from you that that's what we're doing with this one.
Yes, the standard is that they're not to negatively impact those neighbors, and a lot of times that means if there's a known drainage problem, they may have to reduce the rate from what it is now to something lower, or if there's just existing areas down there that are at capacity that they show that they are at or less than the existing runoff rates. So those are the things that we hold that the site plan to during the plan review process.
Good. Thank you.
Andy, thank you. Council, yes, Councilor Staggers?
Yes, I just got a quick question. I was curious, is this land going to be bought by Fairway or leased by Fairway?
Yes, it is. Our intention is to purchase the property and be a long-term owner and operator of that location.
Thank you.
Councilor Staggers, thank you. Yes, Councilor Kiley.
Okay, thank you very much. First of all, I appreciate the input from James and from Richard and from Chuck and from Jeff as well, too. We are sensitive to the needs of the neighborhood. And from what I, what's been communicated to me and what others have communicated here this evening, that Fairway Stores has been receptive to neighborhood comments and suggestions. Most specifically, we've already kicked around drainage quite a bit already. So I think it appears that the problem is actually going to be improved versus negatively impact the owners to the south. Because I have talked with some of the owners to the south, including James and the owner of the dance studio there. so as long as we are certain that we're not going to increase that flow in that direction. The another item that has come up quite a bit was traffic, and we haven't been focused on that quite as much, other than that we're not going to allow cutouts along Bedford as per an agreement, an earlier agreement. Heath, can you address that just a little bit as to a traffic study has been conducted and actually paid for by Fairway Stores, and I thank them for that. And Heath has some preliminary information.
Yeah, we've been reviewing the traffic impact. I'm sorry, Heath Hofte is our principal traffic engineer for the City of Sioux Falls. Sorry.
Separate the mics.
What's that?
Oh, there you go.
Sorry. So we've been preliminarily reviewing the traffic impact study, taking analysis of the access locations. It's something that we do for basically all site plans of this nature that come through the city. What we've really found when we started picking apart the numbers and going through the data, we looked at, could the site work with just one access on Sycamore Avenue versus having to have the two access points? That's something we took a real close look at. What we found is that if we only have one access point on Sycamore Avenue, the access points are basically, it's a failure. It's going to be a really ugly intersection that nobody would really want to be using. The site does need two access points. We also took a step back and looked at it. Okay, in the current zoning, 25,000, if it was just commercial, you know, not necessarily a grocery store, just generic commercial, 25,000 feet square feet, is there a difference in one access versus two? And we found that really, whatever we do at the site, we're going to need two access points to really make it work correctly. So we've been having discussions with Fairway and on their traffic impact study, taking a look at it. We're looking at what we can do on 41st Street to make it as safe as we possibly can for everybody. One of the first things that we'd probably do sometime this summer is when we're restriping 41st Street, the center turn lane on 41st Street going west of Sycamore, we would extend that back through probably both the driveway for the gas station to the north, the proposed driveway for the Fairway site, and through Bedford Avenue. Also, we look at lengthening that so that we have an area for vehicles to safely make those left turns. going forward, looking at the 2035 projections for the site, there is some point where we may be looking at the 41st Street location may have to get rebuilt into some sort of right-in, right-out access situation in order to keep it safe, because I think it's already been talked about a little bit tonight. This is really an older land use development plan and area, and we're transitioning from older standards to newer standards, and it's really, there's compromise on everybody's part to make it work right. So.
Thank you very much. So that is being addressed presently and will continue to be addressed into the future.
Yep.
Unless anyone else has a question for Heath, I've got one other point here that I'd like to make.
Yes. One for Heath. Heath, is one of the things we're looking at would be similar to like some of the other businesses there, that's the slow down lane to get in, since we don't have really turning lanes on 41st Street especially.
We're looking at that for Sycamore Avenue. The problem with 41st Street is that the distance between Bedford Avenue and the driveway isn't long enough to effectively make what we call an effective turn lane. There's a decel lane to the north end of that gas station that was built that you can see on the top of the picture on the screen, that was done with our older standards for deceleration lanes. That deceleration lane does not work very well, and that's about what the one on the south would look like if we had one into the site. So it's actually a situation where with the bike lane in place, it's really safer to not try to build a deceleration lane that's not going to be adequately used correctly. So,
I'm good. Thank you.
Councilor Anderson Jr., thank you. I'm going to go back to you, Councilor Kiley.
Thank you. And the other item that we've heard is the neighborhood feel. And Heath, this isn't necessarily directed toward you. So if you'd like to sit down, you may.
Okay.
Good job, Heath.
Yes, thank you very much. And we're sensitive to all the comments here, whether it was drainage and lighting and landscaping and traffic. And again, I'd like to point out the same thing that I did a few weeks ago, that the rezoning from C2 to C3 is in this case proving to be a benefit to the neighborhood, which is, by the way, my neighborhood as well, because it increases the buffer zone. It also increases the requirement for landscaping. And it's my understanding, too, and this is a question for Jeff Johnson, that this is actually going to be an upgrade to what you normally build in terms of the appearance of the store. Can you address that a little bit?
You bet. What we've got in front of you and what we hope to be submitting to the building department is a new prototype for Fairway, brick clad on four sides. Definitely an upgraded look and feel to our store, adding windows to bring some daylight in to brighten up the inside of that store. But this is a four-sided, 100% brick store. So it from our perspective, and most retailers, this is our Cadillac for sure, and we're excited to get a new prototype in Sioux Falls.
Very good. Thank you. I appreciate that.
Thank you. Before I go back to Councillor Jamieson, councillors, any other comments before I go back to Councillor Jamieson? Councillor Jamieson.
Just one last comment that we sure appreciate Fairway's investment in our community. And from what I've heard from others, there seems to be a connection made with the business owner and others in the community who have a great deal of respect for Fairway and appreciate their courteous behavior and merging into our community. I've been to Boone, Iowa. I'm glad I live in Sioux Falls. But all I wanted to say was I think you've been a fine neighbor coming to our community, and I really appreciate that.
Councilor Jamieson, thank you very much. Council, if there's no other comments, there is a motion. It has been seconded. Really good discussion, good due diligence. And roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jamieson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kiley?
Yes.
Stagers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 39.
Item 39 is a second reading. An ordinance establishing an interim moratorium on the installation of any billboard or issuance of any billboard permits pending further study.
Is Ms. Cooper, you want to kick it off, and then I'll turn it over to Councilor Jameson.
Sure, I'll kick it off. Mike Cooper, Planning and Building Services. Based on previous discussions that we've had with the City Council regarding billboards and off-premise signs that have recently been constructed or that are being considered to be constructed, we talked about the idea of enacting a moratorium. And tonight we have a proposal, second reading, that would enact that moratorium. And just as a background, I wanted to go back and review some information that we had presented earlier. Since April of last year, when the Shade Places ordinance went into effect, through the end of this March of 2015, the Zoning Enforcement Division of our department has issued a total of 26 off-premise sign permits. From April of last year to the end of March of this year, a total of 26 off-premise sign permits. Of those, 7 have been finalized or completed. A total of 5 have been issued without any initial inspections, meaning they either haven't started yet or they haven't gone to the first phase of needing an inspection. 7 have been issued with inspections, and then the remaining ones did not proceed for various reasons. They expired or they chose not to go forward. So again, 26 were issued over the last year. Of those, 7 have been completed, and another 12 are either underway or have been allowed to commence at any time. In addition to that, I just sent out some information today that since the beginning of this month of April, when we were talking about the potential for a moratorium, our office has now received a total of 10 permit applications from 3 different sign companies for off-premise signs. Of those 10, we've approved 1, which we've been under discussion for a number of months regarding our West 12th Street Bridge project. There's an existing billboard on the north side of 12th Street that needs to be moved approximately 60 to 70 feet to the west in order to allow us to move forward with that reconstruction. So that one, we've been discussing it with a sign contractor for many, many months, and we've allowed that one to go forward. The remaining 9 applications, we've been reviewing those, and as of today, none of those have been permitted or authorized to go forward. Part of our review process includes looking at the spacing, looking at the location. In some cases, we have to deal with floodplain requirements, and that requires another permit that has to go through our review. So I wanted you to know that because since the discussion about the moratorium, obviously there has been a burst of proposed activity even beyond the 26 sign permits that we've issued over the last year. So I don't know if there's anybody here that wants to comment on that, but that's the approach that we took. And it's also interesting that of the 9 pending review permits that we're looking at, all but two are would be located within an existing convenience store site. So that's my update for you. If you have any questions,
thanks,
I'll be here. Thank you.
Before I go to Councilor Jameson, this is a second reading. Is there anybody in the audience who wanted to speak to this item? Welcome.
Good evening, Greg Neitzert. As many of you know, I was a big fan of Shade Places. In fact, I campaigned for it. But there were a couple of issues. I did bring to you a year ago my concern that billboards under Shade Places were going to be a problem, and it appears the situation on the ground has vindicated my concern. I would urge you to pass this ordinance so we can address citizen concerns. There is precedent for this. On May 23, 2002, Mayor Munson placed a moratorium on off-premise signs, which are also called billboards, by executive order so a study group could be formed because there was concerns at the time. What came out of that was they expanded the minimum required distance from 300 feet to 600 feet. I believe with time and some tweaks, we can find a compromise everyone can live with. There's a number of common sense changes that we can make that could make a big difference. Radical revision is not required to fix the problem. The root issue is that the commercial district classifications have changed under shape places, and therefore billboards are now allowed in a much larger area than they were before. Under the 1983 ordinance, billboards were only allowed in the C2 commercial district. Most commercial zonings starting in the 1990s were in the C4 planned commercial district, which didn't allow billboards. That fact alone relegated billboards to older commercial districts and corridors such as the central parts of Cliff Avenue and Minnesota Avenue. Now that commercial districts are classified by size and shape places, the C2 and C4 districts no longer have the meaning they did before. As a result, billboards are allowed in areas of town they never were before. That's why you're seeing billboards on the west, east, north, south, areas that you never saw a billboard and you maybe never expected. There's a lot more technical details, but I won't bore you with that. I would say this to the citizens of Sioux Falls. This is your chance to have your voice heard, and I would urge you to take advantage of it. Call or email your city councilors, call or email the planning office, let them know what you would like changed. Be specific. Please understand that state law limits what we can do. We cannot ban billboards entirely. We cannot ban digital billboards. This was recently affirmed in the summary judgment issued by a U.S. District Court in Lamar Outdoor versus the City of Rapid City. That court overturned the portion of a referendum passed by the voters of Rapid City that banned digital billboards because it directly conflicted with state law that allows outdoor signage regardless of the technology used. We cannot discriminate or regulate based on content, but we can impose reasonable regulations. Possible reasonable regulations could include extending the minimum separation distance between billboards. It could be doubled or tripled, possibly. I would note that the Rapid City referendum also increased their spacing distance. That is currently under challenge in that lawsuit, and they haven't ruled as to whether or not that will be allowed. They went from, I think, 1,000 feet to 2,000 feet. Lamar alleges this amounts to a de facto ban on billboards, and the City of Rapid City disagrees. We could add minimum separation distances from sensitive uses such as schools and parks, add minimum separation distances from residential or at least single family, establish a minimum separation distance between an off-premise sign, a billboard, and an on-premise sign. An example would be the billboard directly adjacent to the Flowerama sign at 41st and Marion Road. We could allow billboards adjacent only to certain street classifications, for example, just arterials. We could allow billboards adjacent only to larger commercial forms. We could possibly define what I call corridors to allow billboards only on certain streets and defined areas. That would be much like what we had before. We could prohibit billboards from existing in or encroaching into any required buffer yard. We could limit the Board of Adjustment's power to vary the required spacing between billboards. Currently, we can reduce that spacing as much as we want. We could establish non-conforming billboard sign regulations that ensure at the end of their life they will go away if the existing sign violates one of the new criteria, such as minimum separation distance. With some common sense changes, we can make a world of difference. I would reiterate to citizens to make your voice heard, contact city councilors or the planning department with your ideas. We can address your concerns if you don't make them known. I would encourage you to adopt this resolution. Thank you.
Greg, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Is there anybody else who wanted to speak to this item? Welcome.
Mayor Huther and Council. I'm Jean Fuller. I live at 705 South Gordon Drive. My parents graduated from Washington High. My husband graduated from Washington High. My kids graduated from Washington High. So I've been here forever, maybe one of the oldest people in the room. I don't know. But I wanted to give you a little perspective that I've been around and I've seen how our city grows. I'm very proud of our city. We've got a great place here. Still live in the same house I bought when we were 27 years old. But I've been noticing around town huge billboards lit up all night. And I know perhaps it's a little late for me. I didn't move, I maybe should have. But I can stand on my deck on Gordon Drive at night and see three of them blasting all night long. And so I'm asking that we consider a moratorium, that we think or talk about possibly not needing to have those lights on all night, dimming things, making it so our skyline is, you know, pretty, and our city remains, you know, very residential and very peaceful. I can tell you that several years ago, I worked on a project with RAND, the research agency in California, and I had the researchers come into Sioux Falls, and they were just astounded. They wanted to know the price of our houses and this and that, because they lived in Santa Monica. But the one thing they noticed right away is that you have a lot of casinos here. They were very surprised about that, and the signs and so on. But I would encourage you to, you know, keep going on this moratorium, slow down on the permits that have been issued, and rethink this. So, you know, we have a nice skyline. I encourage you to drive down Sycamore Drive, and as you come to 41st, where the fairway is going to go in, there is, you know, the skyline's really nice there, and all of a sudden there's this just big billboard there. But it's really not attractive, and I don't think it really fits with our city. So I'd encourage you to really rethink that. And as I said to some of the counselors I've talked to, I'm more than willing to serve on any committee. I served on the Event Center Committee, and I'm more than willing to serve on any committee to kind of rectify this. Thank you.
Jean, thank you very much. Appreciate that. Anybody else want to speak to this item? Welcome.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Angela Bailey. I live in Sioux Falls. I also work for Dectronics, which is the largest digital billboard manufacturer based in Brookings. At Dectronics, I specialize in regulatory affairs, where I help state and local regulatory bodies draft digital billboard regulations. As you may know, we have a facility located in Sioux Falls. Our Sioux Falls facility employs about 300 people and consists of over 140,000 manufacturing square feet. This facility also produces all of Dectronics' digital billboard products. We're following this item very closely, as it is very important to our business. There's been previous discussion in past meetings about forming a committee to study the existing billboard regulations. So as a result, if a committee is formed in the future, Dectronics is interested in being a part of that committee. So that's all I have, and I'm available to answer any questions if you have.
Angela, thank you. And thank just you. Give your contact information to Mr. Cooper, please.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who wanted to speak? Yes, welcome.
Good evening.
And Gene, the same applies. Well, we've got your information. Thank you. Appreciate that. I didn't want to not acknowledge you at the same time I acknowledged Angela. Yes.
My name's Corey Andel. I represent Lamar Outdoor Advertising. I guess just hearing all the concerns about it, there are many companies in Sioux Falls, and Lamar does want to be kind of on the forefront and create a plan that wins. We've been meeting with the city several times throughout the year, and we had representation for 18 months before Shape Places took effect. Gave them kind of a history, kind of gave them our recommendation on kind of what was going to happen, and we try to be kind of a team player on it. And I guess my big thing is we just want to be on that committee as well. We're willing to work with the city, and I can't speak for the other signed companies, but we have met with Mr. Cooper, and I know we all kind of speak on the same page that we're willing to work with the city. But I guess my one question I would like on the record is, since it's not an effective moratorium and there are several permits outstanding, what is the city's plan with the outstanding permits?
Very good. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Is there anybody else who wanted to speak to this item? Welcome.
Hi, my name is Wade Greenwood. I'm with Sioux Signs out of Mitchell, South Dakota. I've been doing that for 5 years with Sioux Signs. Before that, for 15 years, I was a lease manager for Lamar Outdoor Advertising. So I had quite a bit of experience with sign codes and property management and what have you. And I actually also remember the 2002 moratorium that the young man spoke about. And that brought about the previous sign code, which actually worked quite well. I'm in support of a moratorium. We do need to stop what's going on right now, take a step back and see moving forward how billboards can work well in Sioux Falls. I do think there's a place for them, but they do need to be regulated.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Anybody else? Council? Councilor Jameson, I'm going to go to you first.
Thank you. First, I wanted to thank the City Council for allowing this to come to the City Council's main agenda after coming from land use right to the council hearing. I think that's just a great sign that you wanted to take immediate action. That normally doesn't happen, but I meant to thank you before. But that's a big deal. So thank you for allowing that to happen. Corey jumped right to the heart of the matter regarding the outstanding permits. And as all of us know here, we've got an amendment that we need to add because we found a problem going forward with those pending permits. What do we do with those? So I'll let Dave maybe cover that. And I think maybe that would really just facilitate us getting that to, if the mayor's willing, just so that we get to what we really need to discuss tonight, because I don't think there's any objections to the moratorium. It's just a matter of the language.
Did you have any other comments before I go to David?
Yeah, I do. I'm sorry. Thank you.
Would you mind finishing your comments? And then I'll go to David, if that's okay.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for. So I did have a chance to meet with a couple of the sign guys out there, Corey and Wade. Are there other sign companies here tonight? Okay. One of the thoughts that came to my mind was these outstanding permits, and I was encouraging Mr. Cooper to have all those employees go on vacation so that they couldn't process any more permits. But that's not right. But I got a sense from a couple of the sign people I talked to about being good neighbors and working together with the city. Corey mentioned that, and I think Wade intends to do the same thing. those outstanding permits that aren't getting that aren't processed completely, or the ones that haven't been executed or construction hasn't started, I got a sense that they were willing to sit down with us perhaps and maybe negotiate. Because I think what they did from last year up until the last 7 days, they've been plowing ahead trying to buy up these permits because they don't know what the future is going to be for them. We could stop all billboards. And so they had to grab probably what they thought they could get. And that's how business is, I suppose. But if we give them some assurance that we're not going to take them out of business, but we want to be reasonable, I think maybe if we could all maybe talk in about those permits that have been issued, maybe we could make sure that we don't wind up with a billboard in the neighborhood that we know we don't want one. I just sensed a willingness from them. I hope that continues, and perhaps we can facilitate a meeting with them to work out some of those differences. The maps that I saw that Mr. Cooper provided, there's only a couple that I'm particularly worried about, and they haven't been built yet. So I think there's opportunities there for us to fix this before we get any further. In lieu of that, Mr. Mayor, I would make a motion.
Yes.
To amend, or what do we need to get there? I'd make a motion to move to approve first.
Second, Anderson.
It's been a motion to approve this item and has been seconded. Councilor Jameson, did you want to make an amendment?
I'll leave it to Councilor Kiley.
Councilor Kiley.
Thank you. Motion to amend. By removing the words installation of any billboards or in the title and removing the words installation of any billboards or the in the fourth paragraph. In the first paragraph of section one, adding or between applications and issue and deleting or allow the installation of. Basically, the amendment.
Is there a second?
Second.
There's a second. Councilor Kiley?
Basically, the amendment removes the language that places a moratorium on incomplete billboards that have already received a permit.
Very good. David, to Councilor Jameson's comments, would you mind giving us some input on this?
Certainly. Thank you, Mayor. First of all, on the proposed amendment, I believe this would affect approximately 12 permits that have been issued based on my math is correct from what Mr. Cooper had stated. And again, this amendment would just address those that have been given the city green light to construct and install a billboard, that the permits that already have been issued would be honored by the city. So that takes away that issue completely. As far as the 10 new applications, again, Mr. Cooper and I have talked about this on a daily basis. His office will continue processing these as usual. However, this ordinance does have an emergency clause in it where it would take effect upon publication, which would be April 11th, this Saturday. In terms of how many more would be issued in that time, again, those are sent to our GIS department to confirm spacing issues. Mr. Cooper also indicated some floodplain issues. Certainly, he's not pocketing them in any way. However, we're going to do our due diligence on those as well and continue in our normal course as far as processing any applications for permits. In terms of how many more of those 10, I know one has been approved. Whether how many of the other nine, I can't say, but again, it will be business as usual until April 11th if you adopt this this ordinance.
Very good. Is there any? Are there any comments in regards to the amendment that Councillor Kiley brought forth? A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kiley?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 7-0. We now have an amended motion. Any comments on the amended motion? Councillor Staggers?
Well, yeah, I have a question. For some time now, I've wondered, how did this all come about? You know, why we have to have an emergency clause in this? Can somebody say something to why this came about all of a sudden? Seems like it came out of the blue sky.
Mr. Cooper?
To address Councilor Stager's question, it came about because of issues that we've heard from the community. We've heard some of them tonight with concerns about the additional placement, the number, the location of billboards, and how this zoning would allow even more to continue into the future. So we were asked to look at how we could step back, take a look at, get a committee that we would put together with representatives of the industry, representatives of different citizens that have interest in this, and just take a look at what the standards should be. And based on our presentation to the council, there was support to consider a moratorium, and now we're bringing that forward. Our concern is the longer it takes for this to go into effect, that number that I have today on my desk, which is 10, could be 20. I don't know. So it really puts us as a staff in a really difficult position the longer this takes to go into effect.
I guess because I've been told that the number of billboards in Sioux Falls today in 2015 is actually a little bit less than it was around the turn of the century, around 2000-2001.
But the locations are much different than they were. That's what we're trying to deal with, is primarily the locations.
So it's not so much that we're having a lot of billboards. You're contending that the problem is the location.
It's both, because the number that you're referring to probably does not include the 26 or the 10 that I just referenced tonight. So yeah, it has changed in terms of numbers and locations, both. And that's what we're trying to address with the moratorium, I think.
And once again, Mike, I just never really heard anything about this until this became an emergency situation. I didn't have constituents call me, oh no, I'm worried about these new billboards or whatever the case might be. I heard that the 41st and Sycamore billboard, that's the one that really got this going. So I went over there to take a look at it. Billboard, I mean, it's not even close to residential housing or anything at all.
Well, again, as staff, we were asked to make a presentation to the council, and based on that presentation, the direction was, let's move forward with a moratorium.
Very good. Councilor Buck.
Just a couple of comments. This is going to shock some of you. I don't disagree with Councilor Staggers this evening. I have received one comment. So a couple of things. One, I love road trips, and I love to drive through Tennessee, because you know what state law in Tennessee is? No billboards ever, anywhere, anyhow, no way, and it's a beautiful state to drive through. And what did Greg just say about the law in South Dakota? Billboards, yes, all the time, everywhere, lighted, unlighted, every kind, big, small, whatever. Billboards are great in South Dakota. We love them. Second thing is that both Councillor Staggers and I live not only in South Dakota, but we both live in the Central District, which is surrounded by the corridors where we've said it's okay to have all these billboards. So in the minimum, maximum, whatever distance between and behind and above and size, we've got them all, and they're within shouting distance of all of our houses, and we're used to it to a certain extent. So our constituents in our neighborhood are like, eh, whatever. We've got billboards. You guys can have billboards. So we haven't heard it. My third concern is one company has already built a whole bunch of billboards under this law, and I'm really concerned that we're not necessarily being fair to the other companies, because honestly, folks, this was approved not only by a previous city council, but it was also approved by the voters. In a referendum election a year ago, this law was approved by not only us, but the voters as well. So obviously, I am going to vote for the moratorium. I think we need to think about it, but I think we need to be realistic that we live in South Dakota and that billboards are a fact of life. I don't disagree with the lighted thing. I don't disagree that it, you know, we have beautiful skies, but we also live in South Dakota. My fourth point then would be I need Greg to be on the task force. All you other folks too, but Greg needs to be on the task force, absolutely. That's what I got.
Councilor Kiley.
Thank you. Again, this is the billboard that Councilor Staggers had referred to is actually directly across the street from the Fairway store that is proposed. And one of the individuals who addressed the Fairway project is also impacted by the new billboard. And I've been contacted by a number of individuals in the area. Some of them that refuse to do business at the business where the billboard is, even though it's not theirs. So I referred it to land use, and so we are where we are here today. And I think I think everybody in this room has so far spoke that they are in approval of the moratorium. To address Councillor Staggers, the one at 41st and Sycamore is within a block of homes that no billboard existed before. And to address Councillor Erpenbach, the difference between the Minnesota Avenue corridor and the 10th Street and 12th Street Avenue corridors, those have been developed commercially since I was a kid. And a long time, you're correct. So these are pocket areas that are now being affected. And yes, we did vote on shape places, but I think everybody would agree, or I would like to think everybody would agree, that we also knew that we would have to tweak shape places from time to time and actually to improve it. And so that's what we're trying to do here with the formation of this committee. And I have referred four different individuals, private citizens, and again, having individuals from the billboard industry, very wise. I mean, we need everybody represented on this so that we can reach a solution.
We have an amended main motion. We've had good discussion. Councilor Staggers, do you have a different comment?
Yeah, I was just curious because Councilor Erpenbach mentioned, you know, we have these billboard companies here in Sioux Falls, and some of them are bigger than others. Can we just simply ask Lamar how many billboards they have and how many Sioux signs has and how much oxygen has or whatever? Just to get an idea of who is...
Mike, do you have any idea, just a distribution, how many billboards we have in town?
I don't have that number with me tonight. I don't have that information.
The gentleman from Lamar, can you just tell me how many billboards you have in town?
165
billboards. And out of that, we did not have probably built 8. We purchased the rest. Thank you.
Councilor Staggers, any other comments? Yeah, Sioux signs. You have 10?
Ten.
It sounds good. Mm-hmm. So did you get your answers, Councilor Staggers?
Just ask that one.
The gentleman from Mitchell?
That's it.
No, last person.
Okay, you've got your 10. Sir, how many do you have?
Excuse me, I was just going to say, Lamar's got a
Tube Media. I know he's not here, but he's a friend of mine. And then Patrick, he's here from Skyline Digital. I'd say we have four signs.
Okay, very good.
We probably got, between the three other companies, we got 25 signs.
Thank you. Very good. For the listening audience, the gentleman said that they've got 25 signs between the three companies to try to give you some perspective. A roll call vote, please.
Voting on the main motion as amended, Councilmember Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
No.
Anderson?
Yes.
That has passed 6-1. Item 40.
Item 40 is a first reading to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, April 14, 2015 at 7 o'clock p.m. An ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, amending the Code of Ordinances of the City by revising 30.025 creation of agencies, authorities, committees, boards, commissions, and districts, and 30.026 rules for boards and commissions.
Mayor?
Yes, David.
Thank you. This is a first reading of an ordinance that would essentially modify the general ordinances on how citizen boards are conducted. The city has about 340 citizens that are currently serving and donating their time and talents to serve on 42 different citizen boards. Citizen volunteers provide a great perspective on a host of issues for the city. Of those 42 boards, for your information, 21 have been created by ordinance, 10 by state law, 2 by the city charter, 4 by agreements, usually joint agreements with the county, and 5 others have been created through various resolutions over the years. The city website has links for all these boards. Each contains their bylaws, minutes of meetings, agendas for upcoming meetings, and other general information. Last fall, we began a top 10 project of reviewing all of the citizen boards, their bylaws, et cetera, trying to streamline the process of appointments, ensuring that we had a central calendar system for tickling when terms of board members was about to expire. And we also met with each of the citizen board liaisons in order to gauge their concerns and if there were any needs for improvement. Kendra Simmonsma acted as the project manager, along with Julie Wilson, Carrie Hansel, and myself. Meetings with those staff liaisons revealed that there were concerns about finding replacement board members, especially for specialized boards such as electrical, plumbing, and mechanical. There were also concerns about member terms, where a member was appointed to serve an unfulfilled term. They were getting maybe 1 year, and then that was counting as one of their only two terms that they could serve, so they were disappointed, frankly, that they couldn't serve longer. And also, the outcomes of this process were that a centralized internal site will be created. We'll have a centralized tickler system. We also provided group training to all the city board liaisons, including especially on open meetings laws. And we've also established a centralized process for handling reasonable accommodations requests, and those go through our human relations office. The ordinance in front of you is based on those concerns that were expressed, trying to address them as best we can. It amends, and as was stated at the public input tonight, and where applicable, it also indicated or state law, since we do have 10 boards that were created by state law. The main changes are in Part E, where we allow a citizen to continue on a board for up to 4 months overlap so that we have time to find a board member replacement if needed, especially, again, say, electrical or mechanical or plumbing board. And this proposed change would also allow a person to serve an unexpired term as long as it wasn't more than one half of a full term. So essentially, a person could serve 2 and 49.9% of terms rather than just, say, 5 years of a 4-year term and a 1-year term. It also codifies the staggering of terms so that we continuously have board members who are experienced. Based on the public input comments tonight, Section F regarding removal of those for cause if they miss more than 50% of any meetings any calendar year, that has been in existence for many years. We never heard any comments or concerns about that. We'll certainly look at that. The other changes are pretty much housekeeping. In 30.026, The main ones are that the draft minutes will be posted within 10 working days. That's a state law. Minutes will now be kept, and they have been for quite some time, on the city website. The central filing with the city clerk was done in prior years because we didn't have everything up on the website. Now they are. If they were to ask for minutes of some board meeting here at the clerk's office, Lori Hogstead has confirmed her staff would simply get on the city website and print off whatever minutes that individual wanted. And then the last portion is on section D, that bylaws would be required to be reviewed annually. This would keep everything up to date. So that is the crux of this proposal.
Thank you, David. Would anybody want to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, April 14th for this item?
So move.
Second, Erpenbach.
This has been motion made and seconded. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 41.
Item 41 is to set a date of hearing and second reading for Tuesday, April 21, 2015 at 7 o'clock p.m. First reading. An ordinance of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, rezoning property at east and west of North Marlow Avenue and north of East Paddington Street from the AG Agricultural District to the RS Single Family Residential Suburban District, petition number 2249-2015, and amending the official zoning map of the City of Sioux Falls. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
Good evening, Diane DeCoyer with Planning. The applicant for this project is John Schutte. The property is located north of North Marlow Avenue and south of the eastern section of Great Bear. The size of the parcel is 26.173 acres. The purpose is to construct 17 single-family homes. Lots range in size from 1.1 to 3.8 acres. A previous developer requested to rezone this property over 6 months ago, in which it was approved by the Planning Commission but denied by City Council due to the neighborhood concerns regarding traffic. The new property owner held a neighborhood meeting to review neighborhood concerns, and I believe he's here tonight to address some of the questions you might have, although it is first reading, so we may put that off to second. There is access to the major street network, and adequate provisions for municipal utilities will occur when sanitary sewer and the water main are extended from the south, running north within the North Marlow right-of-way. A post-construction BMP will also be required.
Dan, thank you. Council, any comments on this or motions?
Move to set the date of hearing, Ms. Erpenbach.
Second, Anderson.
Thank you both. Appreciate that. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yep.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 42.
Item 42 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls approving the preliminary plan of Hidden Meadows Second Edition. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
The applicant for this is Dave Gibbon, and the owners are Chip Carlson and Harold Gooden. The property is located east of North Cliff Avenue and northeast First Street. The size of the lot is 16.4 acres. The applicant is proposing to subdivide the 16.4 acres of land into 45 single-family residential, one multifamily residential, and one recreational open space lot.
I have a seizure.
Thanks, Diane. Did anyone want to speak to this item? Council?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Karski.
Thank you both. There's been a motion to approve it. It has been seconded. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 43.
Item 43 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls approving the preliminary plan of Stone Point at 57th Edition. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
The applicant is Kim Buell. The owner is Smith Development Company. The site is located south of East 57th Street and east of South Lewis Avenue. The size of the lot is 4.75 acres. The subject property was originally a part of the city of the existing City Water Tower property. In 2014, the City of Sioux Falls sold the property to Smith Development Company, which is developing the property before you tonight.
Diane, thank you. Anybody want to speak to this item? Council?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Jameson.
Thank you both. Appreciate that. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach? Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 44.
Item 44 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls approving the preliminary plan of Copper Creek Heights Addition. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
The applicant again is Kim Buell. The owner is Ronning Enterprises. The property is located north of East 41st Street and west of 6 Mile Road. The size of the development is 121 acres. The applicant is proposing to construct 326 single-family lots, two commercial lots, and five multifamily residential lots.
Did anybody want to speak to this item? Council?
Move for approval, Anderson.
Second, Karski.
And a motion to approve this item has been seconded. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 45.
Item 45 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls approving the preliminary plan of Copper Creek Estates Addition. The Planning Commission recommends approval.
The applicant again is Kim Buell. The owner is Ronning Enterprises. This is located at the southwest corner of East 26th Street and South 6 Mile Road. The size is 80 acres. The applicant is proposing to subdivide 80 acres of land into 111 single-family residential lots and one tract for water retention.
Thanks, Diane. Did anybody want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move to approve, Karski.
Second, Kylie.
Councilor Karski has made a motion to approve this item, seconded by Councilor Kylie. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 46.
Item 46 is a resolution to approve a historical marker on city property, mid-air collision at Veterans Memorial Park.
The resolution to approve the historical marker on city property, this would be again at Veterans Memorial Park. This was brought before both the Board of Historic Preservation and the Parks and Rec Board by the Minnehaha County Historical Society.
Move for approval, Anderson.
Thank you, Councilor.
Second, Jameson.
Thank you, Councilor Jameson. Do anybody want to speak to this item? Roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 47.
Item 47 is a resolution to approve a historical marker on city property, Sioux Falls Army Technical School at Veterans Memorial Park.
Same site plan at Veterans Memorial Park, a second historical marker. Again, it was brought before us by the Minnehaha County Historical Society, and again, it was reviewed by Parks and Rec and Board of Preservation.
Diane, thank you. Damon, you want to speak to this item, councilors?
Move to approve.
Second, Erpenbach.
Councilor Jameson, thank you. Councilor Buck, thank you. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 48.
Item 48 is a resolution canceling Main Street Business Improvement District assessments.
Dustin Powers, Community Development Office. This is a resolution canceling three assessments as part of the Main Street Business Improvement District assessments that were levied in December of 2013 for the 2013 Main Street Business Improvement assessments. The reason that these three properties are being canceled is because they were city-owned properties, and so this is just a clerical error that's getting fixed.
Dustin, thank you, and thanks for waiting so long. Appreciate it. Anybody want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move to approve.
Second, Karski.
Councilor Jameson, thank you. Councilor Karski, thank you. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 49.
Item 49 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, approving the removal of visual art wall on public property.
Dustin Powers, Community Development Office again. This is a resolution to approve the removal of the visual art wall that is located on North Phillips Avenue and is referred to as the Invariat Concordia sculpture. On March 10th, the City Council voted to approve an agreement with AR Properties to sell that property. And as part of that agreement, the city agreed to remove the sculpture from the property. This was brought in front of the Visual Arts Commission on March 17th, and they recommended that we store the item until it's brought back in front of them to make a recommendation on what to do with the sculpture going forward. There are also the reason to put it in storage, there are some condition issues with the sculpture currently, from environmental issues. Also, it's, I believe, been hit by a vehicle before in the past, so there is some repair that also needs to be done to it. So at this time, we would just be removing it, putting it in storage, and then going back to the Visual Arts Commission for approval or recommendation at a later date.
Thank you. Did anybody want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move to approve, Ruppenbach.
Second, Kylie.
Councilor Ruppenbach's made a motion to approve this item, second by Councilor Kylie. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Ruppenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Stagers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 50.
Item 50 is a resolution supporting the candidacy of Michael Hall for a position on the Board of Directors of the South Dakota Public Assurance Alliance.
Mr. Feifley.
Thank you, Mayor. This is a resolution that would give this body's support for the candidacy of risk manager Mike Hall to run for re-election on the Board of Directors of the Public Liability Pool. You have previously approved his candidacy in his first term, and also you've approved Tracy Turback on prior occasions as well. Again, this is just expressing your support.
Thank you, David. Did anybody want to speak to this item? Councilors?
Move to approve.
Second, Kylie.
Councilor Jameson made that motion, seconded by Councilor Kylie. A roll call vote, please.
Council members Erickson?
Yes.
Ruppenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Stagers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 51.
Item 51 is a resolution of the City of Sioux Falls, South Dakota, approving the placement of a sculpture on public property, effortlessly buoyant, at the northwest corner of Lyon Park, located at the southeast corner of 14th Street and Phillips Avenue.
Good evening. As Tamara said, this is a sculpture that is currently located downtown, and it is with the All Saints Neighborhood Association that they have paid for a one-year lease to have this located at the corner there of 14th and Phillips Avenue. To the right on the screen is the sculpture itself, which stands about 7 feet tall. Here are a couple of photos that indicate the granite where the sculpture would be located at Lyon Park. I can answer any questions you might have.
Thank you. Appreciate that, Diane. And I do know we've got the president of the association here. You've been waiting around for 2.5 hours. Would you at least just let the people of Sioux Falls know who would be willing to do that? Would you mind just standing up and introducing yourself to the town? Mm. They've seen you on TV a little bit lately, too, but.
Hi, I'm Katrina Laren McKinney. I'm president of All Saints Neighborhood Association. Our neighborhood worked in collaboration with the Parks and Rec Department on the renovation of Lyon Park last year, and it was a real success and such a positive thing for our neighborhood. Part of the revitalization was the placement of a piece of granite. And through talking with Jim Clark of Sculpture Walk, he said that they had a sculpture available if we were interested in leasing for a year. So our neighborhood has pooled some money together through individuals and some businesses in the neighborhood to raise the $1,000 to pay for the lease. I believe we hit our fundraising goal this week. So we're really excited to have a piece of public art in the park. And that's definitely something that we had talked about with the Parks Department from the very beginning of the revitalization of the park.
Katrina, thank you. Would you mind telling the people of Sioux Falls how much you get paid to do your job? It's zero, isn't it?
Yeah.
That's what I thought. Well, I thank you for your stewardship, and what a great example you are for other people in this town, too. Thank you.
Thank you.
Councilors, any motions on this one?
Move to approve, Ruppenbach.
Second.
Councilor Boxman, a motion to approve this. It has been seconded by Councilor Anderson, Jr. Thank you both. A roll call vote, please.
Councilmembers Erickson?
Yes.
Erpenbach?
Yes.
Jameson?
Yes.
Karski?
Yes.
Kylie?
Yes.
Staggers?
Yes.
Anderson?
Yes.
That is passed 7-0. Item 52.
Item 52 is a report of the March 31st, 2015 Notice of Transfer of Appropriations Within Major Organizational Units.
Thank you. Councilors, any other comments?
Move to adjourn.
Thank you, Councilor.
Second.
Thank you. Appreciate that, Councilor Jameson. All those in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? Well, Councilors, I know you've been here since at least 4 o'clock, if not earlier. We thank you for your public service. It's now 9:30. This meeting is adjourned, Sioux Falls. Thank you for your service, Councilors.